Welcome students. Today I am going to discuss about the third chapter of contemporary world politics. Again it is a new chapter according to CBSE which is called new centers of power instead of alternative centers of power. In this chapter we'll learn about the different organizations and nations like European Union, ASEAN, SHRC, BRICS, Russia, China, Israel and India. Now today we are going to discuss about European Union as an organization. Now what is European Union? The European Union or EU is a political and economic organization with 27 member states which are located in Europe. The EU was created after the Second World War. Previously, its name was European Economic Community or EEC. Now, it has become the European Union in 1993. Now, the point is, what is the background of the emergence of new center of powers? After the end of the bipolar structure of world politics in the early 1990s, it became clear that alternative centers or new center of powers of political and economic power could limit America's dominance or US dominance. The Cold War aided the integration of Europe after 1945. The European was revived by the financial support under the Marshall Plan by USA. Now, what was this Marshall Plan? The Marshall Plan was also known as European Recovery Program. It was an American initiative passed in 1948 for providing foreign aid to Western European countries due to devastation of World War II. Okay, then the US president that time, Truman, stated that America should provide moral and financial assistance to those countries for political unity was endangered by communism. This policy came to be known as Truman Doctrine. It was felt that European economy needed recovery. In 1947, American Secretary of State George Marshall presented an economy recovery program for Europe. It was a plan for American assistance in promoting European rehabilitation and reconstruction after Second World War. The former Soviet Union was also invited to be a partner in this program, but Soviet Union and other communities dismissed this offer as another political move of the US. This economic recovery program was carried on cooperatively in the 4 years between 1948 to 1952. Okay. Now the formation of European Union. It is a political economic union of now 27 member states. You already know about this. Okay. The EU has developed an internal single market through a standard system of laws that apply in all member states in those matters, and only those matters where members have agreed to act as one. EU policies aim to ensure the free movement of people, goods, services and capital within the internal market, enact legislation in justice and home affairs, and maintain common policies on trade, agriculture, fisheries and regional development. For travel within the passport controls have been abolished. Monetary union was established in 19 According to the United Nations Development Programme in 2012, the European was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. Through the Common Foreign and Security Policy, the EU has developed a role in external relations and defense also. The European Union maintains permanent diplomatic missions throughout the world and represents itself at the United Nations, the World Trade Organization, the G7 and the G20. Due to its global influence, the European Union has been described as emerging superpower. Stability by means of a single currency, an European Central Bank, common foreign security policy as to ensure a lasting peace in Europe, bridging the gap between rich and poor regions in Europe. The member countries have entered into agreements to tackle such issues as wildlife protections and protection of forests. Initially, the leaders of European Union outlined a program of economic integration, but gradually they succeeded in bringing about both economic integration and political union. The European Union has now grown into a multinational dimensional organization whose profound impact is visible in the economic, political and military and diplomatic influenced fields. Economically, the European Union is the world's biggest economy. It had a GDP of more than $12,000 billion early in 2005. Its currency, euro, can pose a threat to the dominance of the US dollar. The European Union can now play an important role in international economic organizations such as the World Bank and World Trade Organization. The chairman of European Commission participates in G7, now G8. Submits and influences the decisions taken at these meetings. Politically, European Union also plays a very important role in the world politics. European Union governments have often acted in collaboration with USA, but several occasions there were no unanimity among member countries regarding some of the US policies. For example, on the question of attacking Iraq, Britain and Spain were on the side of the US. But France and Germany opposed this action. In the defense field also, EU possesses second largest army in the world. Total spending on defense is second after the US. Two European Union member states, Britain and France, also have nuclear arsenals of approximately 550 nuclear warheads. It is also the world's second. So student, this is all about European Union. Hope it will be helpful to you, but you have to study well. Thank you. Welcome students. Now I am going to discuss about the topic of ASEAN, of new centers of power, from the book of Contemporary World Politics. Now, what is ASEAN? ASEAN is the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, which is a regional intergovernmental organization of 10 member countries in Southeast Asia. These are Brunei, Cambodia, Indonesia, Laos, Malaysia, Myanmar, Philippines, Singapore, Thailand and Vietnam. Now, what is the objective of ASEAN? The principal objective of ASEAN, as stated in the declaration, is to accelerate economic growth, social progress and cultural development in the region through joint partnership in the spirit of equality. ASEAN was established on 8 August 1967 in Bangkok by the five original members like Indonesia, Malaysia, Philippines, Singapore and Thailand with the signing of the ASEAN Declaration or Bangkok Declaration. Okay, now what is the Bangkok Declaration? The ASEAN Declaration or Bangkok Declaration is the founding document of Association of Southeast Asian Nations. It was signed in Bangkok on 8 August 1967 by the five ASEAN founding members, Indonesia, Malaysia, Philippines, Singapore and Thailand. So it is a display of solidarity against communist expansion in Vietnam and communist insurgency with their own borders. So it was necessary to maintain stability in those areas. So according to ASEAN Declaration or Bangkok Declaration, the main mottos of the association are to develop the economic growth, social progress and cultural development in this region through joint partnership in the spirit of equality in order to strengthen the foundation for a prosperous and peaceful community of ASEAN. So basic principles of ASEAN mainly cooperation, amity and non-interference. The ASEAN Secretariat is located at Jakarta, Indonesia. Now, what was the background of ASEAN? Before and during Second World War, the Southeast Asia suffered a lot from repeated colonialism under the domination of European powers and Japan. The United States was also making efforts to include Southeast Asia into its sphere of influence. In Vietnam, the communist and non-communist forces were at war against each other during the Cold War. They had backing of major powers, mostly China and US. The worst thing was it had led to the partition of Vietnam into two separate states, North Vietnam and South Vietnam. In 1976, that the North and South were reunited again as the Socialist Republic of Vietnam. Cambodia was also faced the civil war. There were problems of nation building, poverty and economic backwardness and a pressure to align with any of the two super blocs like US and USSR. The fact was the Cambodian civil war was a civil war between the forces of the Communist Party of Kampuchea against the government forces of the Kingdom of Cambodia. In October 1970, the Khmer Republic, which had succeeded the kingdom, both supported by the United States and South Vietnam. So, the Association of Southeast Asian Nations is a regional intergovernmental organization comprising 10 countries in Southeast Asia, which promotes intergovernmental cooperation and facilitates economic, political, security, military, educational and socio-cultural integration among its members and other countries in Asia. The motto of ASEAN is one vision, one identity, one community. Okay. On the ASEAN logo, the ASEAN flag, the 10 stalks of paddy rice represent the 10 Southeast Asian countries bound together in friendship and solidarity. The circle symbolizes the unity of ASEAN. The circle shows the unity of purpose among the members. So, the objectives of ASEAN are to promote the economic growth, social progress and cultural development in the region. Fifth, to promote Southeast ASEAN studies. Sixth, to maintain close cooperation with existing international and regional organizations with similar aims and purposes. ASEAN activities. The ASEAN Secretariat has its headquarters at Jakarta, the capital of Indonesia. Special committee have been formed to implement ASEAN projects in their respective fields such as trade and tourism, industry, minerals and energy, finance, banking, transport and communications. In addition to this, there are several ad hoc committees. The ASEAN Way. What is the ASEAN Way? The fundamental principle of this organization is that there should not be any intervention in the internal matters of the member nations and that their sovereignty should be respected. One most important characteristics of ASEAN Way is a system of consensual decision making through discussion in which open disagreement and controversy are avoided at all costs. If there is no agreement, the members agree to disagree. They do not impose their opinions and beliefs on member nations who are in a minority. When there is a dispute, members set it aside and concentrate on cooperation in other areas. In 2003, an ASEAN community was second pillar, ASEAN Economic Community. As you know, ASEAN was and still mainly an economic organization. While the ASEAN region as a whole is a much smaller economic compared to the US, EU and Japan, its economy is growing much faster than all this. This accounts for the growth in its influence both in the region and beyond. According to a discussion reached at Bangkok summit in 1995, efforts were to be made to speed up the creation of the ASEAN Free Trade Area or AFTA. A pact was also signed regarding intellectual property rights. Now, what is AFTA? The creation of the ASEAN Free Trade Area or AFTA was formed in 1992. ASEAN Summit in Singapore. Now, what are the main objectives or principles of the AFTA? The main objectives of the AFTA are to create a single market and an international production base, attract foreign direct investments and expand intra-ASEAN trade and investments. The primary goals of AFTA seek to increase ASEAN's competitive edge as a production base in the world market through the elimination within ASEAN of tariffs and non-tariff barriers and attract more foreign direct investment to ASEAN. So these are the main objectives of AFTA. Its Vision 2020 has defined an outward-looking role for ASEAN in the international community. Now, what is Vision 2020 of ASEAN? The ASEAN Vision 2020, adopted by the ASEAN leaders, it is a historic document as a result of coup d'état in Thailand, unrest in Philippines and military dictatorship in Myanmar. The Vision 2020 is of ASEAN as a concept of Southeast Asian nations based on outward looking, living in peace, stability and prosperity, bounded together in partnership, in dynamic development and in a community of caring societies. ASEAN shall have by this year 2020 established a peaceful and stable Southeast Asia, which each nation is at peace with itself and where the causes for conflict have been eliminated through abiding respect for justice and the rule of law and through the strengthening of national and regional stability. And was felt that ASEAN countries should meet at least twice a year to discuss East Asia of ASEAN, especially its economic relevance as a trading an investment partner to the growing ASEAN economies such as India and China makes this an attractive position. Okay. India now continued to pursue closer relations with countries in Southeast Asia in line with Look East policy. Okay. Taken as a single entity, ASEAN represents the world's third largest market after China and India and the world's third largest labor force with 630 million people. ASEAN is expected to become the world's fourth largest economy by 2030. Okay, so these are the main points of ASEAN. Hope students you understand these points. Now you have to read the books thoroughly, then you can understand more effectively. Okay, thank you. Welcome students. Now I am going to discuss about SAARC as an organization of new centers of power. Its formation, what are the objectives, principles, functions, achievements and recent developments in relation between India and SAARC countries. Now what is SAARC? The South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation, or SAARC, is an economic and geopolitical organization that was established to promote socio-economic development, stability and welfare economics and collective self-reliance within its member nations. Founded during a summit in 1985. SAARC's initial members include Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Maldives, Nepal, Pakistan and Sri Lanka and Afghanistan. The principles of SAARC are sovereign equality, territorial integrity and national independence as it strives to attain sustainable economic growth. Okay. So SAARC is an organization of South Asian nations. It was founded in 1984 for economic, technical, technological, social and cultural development, emphasizing collective self-reliance. And it had 8 members. They are Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Maldives, Nepal, Pakistan, Sri Lanka and Afghanistan. Afghanistan joined this organization in 2007. Headquarters are in Kathmandu, Nepal. The SAARC was founded first in Dhaka. Okay. The organization promotes development of economic and regional integration mainly. Now, why SAARC was formed? SAARC provides a platform for the peoples of South Asia to work together in a spirit of friendship, trust and understanding. It aims to promote the welfare of the peoples of South Asia and to improve their quality of life through accelerated economic growth, social progress and cultural development in the region. Okay. Now, how did SAARC establish? The idea of regional or cooperation in South Asia was first raised in November 1980. After consultations, the foreign secretaries of the 7 founding countries like Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Maldives, Nepal, Pakistan, Sri Lanka. They met for the first time in Colombo in April 1981. Then Afghanistan became the newest member of SAARC at the 13th annual summit in 2005. Now, what are the principles of SAARC? Principles: cooperation within the framework of the SAARC shall be based on respect for the principles of sovereign equality, territorial integrity, political independence, non-interference in the internal affairs of other states and mutual benefit. Okay. First Shark Summit was in Bangladesh. President H.M. Isha's reception of Shark, he substates in Dhaka. The first summit was held in Dhaka, Bangladesh on 7 to 8 December 1985. Okay. And it was attended by the government representative and president of Bangladesh, Maldives, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, the kings of Bhutan and Nepal, and the Prime Minister of India also signed the Shark Charter on 8 December 1985. So, thereby establishing the regional association and established study groups on the problems of terrorism and drug trafficking, as well as the planning a ministerial level meeting about GATT and a ministerial level conference on increasing the participation of women at the regional level. So the summit was also agreed to establish a Shark Secretariat and adopted an official Shark Album. Now, what is the meaning of GATT? The General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade is a legal agreement between many countries whose overall purpose was to promote international trade by reducing or eliminating trade barriers such as tariffs or quotas. The GATT and its successor, the WTO, have successfully reduced tariffs. Okay. Next. The 19th summit was held in Pakistan. Okay. Pakistan scheduled to host the 19th Summit on South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation or SAARC in Islamabad on 15 to 16 November 2016. India, including Afghanistan, Bhutan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka and Maldives, did not attend SAARC Summit due to 2016 Uri attack. Student, as you know, what Uri attack? Do you know? Okay. There was an attack by four heavily armed terrorists on 18 September 2016 near the town of Uri in the Indian administrative state of Jammu and Kashmir. It was reported as the deadliest attack on security forces in Kashmir in 2 decades. Okay. At the time of the attack, the Kashmir Valley region was the center of unrest. Heavily armed terrorists from Pakistan occupied Kashmir, crossed the line of control and launched an attack on an Indian army camp in Kashmir's Uri on September 18. Okay, the terrorists struck the camp at about 5:30 a.m. This was the most severe attack on the armed forces in Kashmir in close to 2 decades. So it was the story of Uri attack. Okay. Pakistan postponed the SAARC summit and announced that new dates would be released soon, but it did not happen. Pakistani Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif, in his address to the 19th SAARC summit being held in the Pakistan capital, said that the object of the summit was to address the security issues between India and Pakistan. Hours after, Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi decided to boycott the SAARC. Okay. Now, what are the objectives of SAARC? The objective of the SAARC are to promote the welfare of the people of South Asia and to improve their quality of life. Then, to accelerate the economic growth, social progress and cultural development in the region. Third, to contribute to mutual trust, understanding among members. Fourth, to strengthen cooperation with the developing nations. Fifth, to strengthen cooperation among themselves in international forums on matters of common interest. Sixth, to promote and strengthen selective self-reliance among the countries of South Asia. Seven, these are the main objectives of SAARC. Okay. No. SAARC has three principal organs. They are, one, meeting of heads of states or government; second, standing committee of foreign secretaries; third secretariat. These are the three principal organs of SHARC. Now, first, meeting of heads of state of government are held at the summit level, usually on an annual basis. Then, Standing Committee of Foreign Secretaries. The committee provides overall monitoring and coordination, determines priorities, mobilizes resources and approves projects and financing. Lastly, Secretariat. The SHARC Secretariat was established in Kathmandu on 16 January 1987. Its role is to coordinate and monitor the implementation of SHARC activities. Service, the meetings of this association, and serves as a channel of communication between SHARC and other international organizations. Okay. Now, what its importance? It is the world's most densely populated region and one of the most fertile areas. SHARC countries have common tradition, race, food and culture and political aspects, thereby their action. Common solutions. All the SHARC countries have common problems like poverty, illiteracy, malnutrition, natural disasters, internal conflicts, industrial and ecological backwardness, low GDP and poor socio-economic condition, and uplift their living standards, thereby creating common areas of development and progress, having common solutions. Okay. Now, what its achievements? SHARC has made some very good achievement that has not only helped the countries in South Asia but have made some good impact in global economical and political development also, like regional cooperation. According to the declaration of the 16th SHARC Summit, April 2010, SHARC's scope and substance of cooperation had expanded to diverse fields. Nations. These meetings have somewhat led to the progress in regional cooperation. Second achievement, discussion and mutual problems. SHARC has enabled South Asian political leaders to meet regularly and carry on informal discussions to address their mutual problems. Third achievement, in reducing widespread poverty. Ever since its formation in 1985, SHARC has made several attempts to address the issue of poverty. The SHARC Charter, drafted in 1985, referred to enhancing the living standards and improving the welfare of the peoples via regional cooperation, initiation of integrated program of action like IPAs, incorporated this people's welfare related objective in the charter by forming IPAs in agriculture and rural development. Human resources development and social development, when the 6th SHARC Summit took place in Colombo in 1991. The heads of states of SHARC countries decided to appoint the Independent South Asian Commission on Poverty Alleviation, ISACPAL, to study and recommend policies to address this pressing issue of the region. Then, strengthening energy cooperation. There is a wide variation in commercial energy resource and commercial energy demand among the South Asian countries like India, Bangladesh and Pakistan account for the major share of natural gas and coal resources in the region. However, these countries are also large in terms of area as well as population, and thus the higher resource base does not necessarily indicate sufficiency to meet energy needs. Bhutan and Nepal, on the other hand, have hydropower potential in excess of their demand for electricity over the forest future and offer the best prospects for intra-regional electricity export. Neighboring regions, particularly Central Asia and Western Asia, have inter-regional energy export capability. This SHARC has played a vital role in proper cooperation for meeting energy demands of South Asia. And last, agriculture. The SHARC Agricultural Information Center SAIC, the first regional institution of SHARP, started functioning in Dhaka in January 1989. Its main objective is sharing information mutually for advancement of agricultural, fisheries, forestry and allied disciplines. The problems and prospects of agriculture and ecology of the SHARP countries are more or less the same. United by same geographical boundaries and historical ties, sharing a common experience shall be mutually helpful for all. The SHARP Technical Committee of Agriculture, like TCA, underscored the need for a regional information system effective for promotion of cooperation in the field of agriculture among the minister countries, member countries, and proposed to the SHARP Standing Committee for Establishment of SHARP in Bangladesh. The Standing Committee in a sixth session approved the proposal and sent it with the recommendations to the Council of Ministers for consideration and promotion of trade. Okay, now there are some examples of achievements that we can consider as positive outcomes, like SAFTA, South Asian Free Trade Area, then SAPTA, South Asian Preferential Trading Agreement, Customs Union, SHARP Monetary Union by 2020. These are some achievements by SHARP, though a few were still undergoing. Now, SHARP achievements like Free Trade Area FTA, it is a comparatively a new organization in the global arena. The member countries have established a Free Trade Area or FTA, which will increase their internal trade and to lose the trade gap of some states considerably. Now, what are the recent developments? Welcome students. Now, I am going to discuss about a new topic which has been added in new syllabus of political science according to CBSE board. This is about BRICS. Now, what is BRICS? BRICS is a group of countries for an association of like five major emerging national economies: Brazil, Russia, India, China and South Africa. Originally, the first four were grouped as BRIC instead of the BRICS before the induction of South Africa in 2010. After joining South Africa, it has become BRICS. Okay. BRICS headquartered in Shanghai, China. Its main objectives are to cooperate between the member nations for development, provide financial assistance, support various projects, infrastructure, etc. State leaders are Jair Bolsonaro, Vladimir Putin. Jair Bolsonaro is a president of Brazil. Vladimir Putin is a president of Russia since 2012. The BRICS acronym or term, a concept floated for the first time in 2001. The idea was coined by economist Jim O'Neill of Goldman Sachs in a paper as part of an economic modeling exercise to forecast global economic trends over the next half century. He expected them to grow faster than the developed countries and to play an increasingly important role in the global economy. And the BRICS acronym or term, a concept floated for the first time in 2001, as you already know. In his paper, O'Neill argued that since the four BRIC countries were developing rapidly by 2050, their combined economics could eclipse all the economics of the richest countries in the world. The BRICS acronym has come to be used as a symbol of the shift in global economic power away from the developed G7 economics, like the US, and toward the developing world. The five nations it combined would be the largest entity on the global stage, according to Goldman Sachs, which has continued to monitor the four countries since 2001. They are considered among the biggest and the fastest growing emerging markets, or those markets still developing. Many analysts consider the BRICS a good place for investment because of their growing populations, infrastructure building and expensive middle class. Now, Who is this person? Who is Jim O'Neill? He is a British economist, best known for coining BRICS, the acronym that stands for Brazil, Russia, India and China, the four rapidly developing countries that have come to symbolize the shift in global economic power away from the developed G7 economics. He is also former chairman of Goldman Sachs Asset Management and former conservative government minister. Now, what is G7? The group of seven, or G7, is an international intergovernmental economic organization consisting of the seven largest IMF or International Monetary Fund advanced economics in the world, like Canada, France, Germany, Italy, Japan, the United Kingdom and the United States, who are the most developed countries in the world. Now, what is Goldman Sachs Asset Management? Goldman Sachs Asset Management is one of the world's leading investment managers with over 2,000 professionals across 33 offices worldwide. GSAM provides institutional and individual investors with investment and advisory solutions with strategies spanning asset classes, industries and geographies. Now, what makes the BRIC countries powerful? Okay, the BRICS members are known for their significant influence on regional affairs. All are members of G20 since 2009. The BRICS nations have met annually at formal summits. China hosted the 9th BRICS summit in Xiamen on September 2017, while Brazil hosted the most recent 11th BRICS summit on 13-14 November 2019. In people are about 41% of the world population, 4 out of 5 members excluding South Africa were in the top 10 of the world by population as of 2018. These five nations had a combined nominal GDP of US$18.6 trillion, about 23.2% of the gross world product. The BRICS have received both praise and criticism for numerous commentators. Bilateral relations among BRICS nations are conducted mainly on the basis of non-interference, equality and mutual benefit. So finally, after studying BRICS, we have come to point to say that first point is BRIC is an acronym for the developing nations of Brazil, Russia, India and China, countries believed to be the future dominant suppliers of manufactured goods, services and raw materials by 2015. Second, China and India will become the world's dominant suppliers of manufactured goods and services respectively, while Brazil and Russia will become similarly dominant suppliers of raw materials as of 2010. South Africa joined the group, which is now referred to as BRICS. Third, economists believe these four nations will become dominant suppliers of manufactured goods, services and raw materials by 2050 due to low labor and production costs. But BRICS are being criticized also. Critics argue that nations' raw materials are limitless and the growth models ignore the finite nature of fossil fuels, uranium and other critical heavily used resources. Okay. Initial for BRIC General States, Brazil, Russia, India and China met in New York City in September 2006. Okay. Now, what are the objectives of BRICS? First, to improve global situation. Okay. Then to reform financial instructions, to cooperate and distribute mutual economic benefits among its members without interfering in internal policies of each nations and mutual equality. Acha. BRIC also established a new development bank. Idea was given by India in 2012. Last BRICS summit was signed in 2019. But very recent activities of BRICS are BRICS to adopt anti-COVID strategy as India pushes momentum to grow. BRICS CCI starts women's going to support entrepreneurs and professionals. China welcomes support from BRICS to its efforts to combat coronavirus. Okay. So, students, this is the general concept of BRICS. I think it will be enough and also helpful for your understanding. Thank you. Welcome, students. Now, I am going to discuss about another new topic, that is Russia as a nation. So, Russia is the largest country in the world, covering more than 1/8 of the Earth's inhabited land area. Russia is also the most populous nation. Russia has the largest reserves and its largest exporter, natural gas. It has the second largest coal reserve, the 8th largest oil reserves, and the largest producer of oil. It is the 3rd largest energy user. Russia produced an average of 10.83 million barrels of oil per day, according to December 2015. It produces 12% of the world's oil and similar share of global oil exports. It was the most powerful republic of the former Soviet Union. Its capital and largest city is Moscow. The country officially the Russian Federation, which is commonly referred to as Russia, is located partly in Eastern Europe and partly in North Asia. It borders the Arctic Ocean to the north. During the Cold War period, when nuclear weapons were the security foundation of the Soviet Union, they have now moved to a secondary role. Now, natural gas is the main foundation on which Russia intends to maintain its role as a superpower. When the Cold War ended, Russia found themselves in a situation where they could be called as a loser of the ideological struggle, capitalist versus socialist. That was the Cold War. Faced with a world that was changing and a nation that was also changing, Russia had to revive themselves in order to find their place in this new world order. Okay, Russia is bordered by 14 countries. They are Azerbaijan, Belarus, China, Estonia, Finland, Georgia, Kazakhstan, North Korea, Latvia, Lithuania, Mongolia, Norway, Poland, Ukraine. It also shares maritime borders with Japan, Sweden, Turkey, and United States. Okay, the capital and largest city is Moscow. The core of political power and the center of culture and trade, St. Petersburg, the former imperial capital, is Russia's second largest city and an important Russian port on the Baltic Sea. Now, Russian Federation. What is this Russian Federation? The double-headed eagle is a state symbol of Russian Federation. Okay, now what is the background of the formation of Russia? The defeat of the Russian Empire in the World War I led to the hold of power by Communist Party and the formation of the USSR. The brutal rule of Joseph Stalin, 1924 to 1953, strengthened Russian dominance of the Soviet Union. After Stalin died in March 1953, he was succeeded by Nikita Khrushchev as first secretary of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union. Then, the Soviet economy and society stagnated in the following decades until General Secretary Mikhail Gorbachev, 1985 to 1991, introduced glasnost, means openness, and perestroika, restructuring, in an attempt to modernize communism. Students, you already heard about this reforms, which is from second book of contemporary world politics, chapter number 2, the end of bipolarity. So, I am not discussing in detail. Gorbachev's domestic reforms, the nuclear disarmament deals helped in the Cold War, but ultimately led to the dramatic downfall of communism in Europe. So, his initiatives inadvertently released forces that by December 1991 splintered or divided into 15 independent republics. In the year 1990, when the declaration of sovereignty of the Russian Soviet Federative Socialist Republic was adopted, or then the Russia was born. The USSR legally ceased to exist on December 31, 1991. The new state called the Russian Federation set off on the road of to democracy and a market economy without any clear conception of how to complete such a transformation. The world's largest country, like most of the other former Soviet Republic. Okay. Then what happened? Okay. It gained independence in a state of serious disorder and economic chaos in 1991. The Democratic Party and its leader Boris Yeltsin was left in control of Russia after replacing the Communist Party. The Democrats had a major problem on their hands in order to completely get rid of communism. Okay. On October 20, 1991, Yeltsin finally announced several drastic changes that would begin the transition. Prices of common products, which had been controlled by the government until now, would be set free by the end of the year, and privatization would begin. This plan was known as shock therapy. Privatization was individual purchase of almost everything that once been controlled by the state, including land, retail stores and factories. The shock therapy plan also opened Russia to foreign investments. The Russian people were not ready for the sudden economic freedom, and a number of problems arose. Then many factories were forced to shut down because the government no longer supported them financially in return for their goods. In the first 5 years after the collapse, the Russian economy contracted to approximately half its former size. Problems of economic transition were aggravated by the disruption of trading links to neighboring newly independent states. As unemployment and underemployment grew, the ruble's value collapsed, destroying people's savings. While the Soviet system had always provided a basically adequate standard of living for most of its citizens, the post-Soviet economic transition, currency collapse, mass unemployment and disintegration of the social safety net took away the population's economic security. Okay. Since then, Russia has struggled in its efforts to build a democratic political system and a market economy to replace the strict social, political and economic controls of the Communist Party period. Then Russia shifted to a centralized authoritarian state under President Vladimir Putin, 2000 to 2008 and 2012 to present, in which the regime seeks to legitimize its rule through managed elections, populist appeals and a foreign policy focused on enhancing the country's geopolitical influence. Okay. When Vladimir Putin assumed the presidency in 1999, the agenda was reasonably clear. Okay. Maintaining and enhancing his own hold on power, regenerating central control over Russia's regional authorities, and in particular preventing the loss of further territory or the spread of insurgency in Chechnya and the North Caucasus, Caucasus more broadly, as one prominent commentator observed on March 26, 2000, Vladimir Putin inherited a weak, corrupt and paralyzed country on the verge of disintegration, because Putin's strategic goal was to get Russia back on his feet, in what, in other words, The starting point of contemporary Russian foreign policy was a reasonably clear-headed recognition of Russian weakness, both internally and in comparison with the other great power. Okay. Now, the Constitution of Russia. The Russian Federation has a multi-party system. As of 2018, 6 parties have members in the federal parliament. The State Duma with one dominant party. After the perestroika reforms in the 1980s, Russia had over 100 registered parties, but the people elected to the State Duma represented only a small number of parties. After 2000, during Vladimir Putin's first presidency, 2000 to 2008, Vladimir Putin, Russia's dominant political figure since 2000, has enhanced his control over the state institution and the media. Russia made uneven progress in democratization during the 1990s, but this limited progress was reversed after Vladimir Putin rose to power in 1999 to 2000. According to many observers, during this period, the State Duma, meaning lower legislative chamber, became dominated by government-approved parties. Governor elections were abolished. Okay. So, the Putin's government showed low regard for the rule of law and human rights in suppressing insurgency in the North Caucasus, according to critics. So, now, Russia's economy. What is the concept of Russia's economy? Students, as you know that Russia's economy began to recover from the Soviet collapse in 1999, led mainly by oil and gas exports. But what happened is, then the decline in oil and gas prices and other aspects of the global economy downturn beginning in 2008 contributed to an 8% drop in gross domestic product in 2009. Since then, rising world oil prices have supported the economy, although reduced energy exports, flattering investment and consumer demand have contributed to slow economic growth in 2013. Other factors that rated economic growth include unreformed healthcare and educational institutions and high rates of crime, corruption, capital flight and unemployment also in Russia. So next is Russia's armed forces. Russia's armed forces now number less than 1 million, down from 4.3 million Soviet troops in 1986. In the 1990s and much of the 2000s, troop readiness, training, morale and discipline suffered and most arms industries became antiquated. Russia's economic growth in recent years has supported greatly increased defense spending to restructure the armed forces and improve their quality. Mismanagement, changes in plans, corruption, managing issues and economic constraints have complicated this restructuring of Russia. So students, this is all about Russia, you know. Hopefully you have got good information about the same. Now you will have to study in detail for the next. Thank you. Welcome students. So now I am going to discuss about China as an emerging power of new centers of power that is added in NCERT book of contemporary world politics. So China officially is known as People's Republic of China. It is a country located in East Asia. It is the world's most populous country. It is the world's third largest country by area. Capital is Beijing, President Xi Jinping. Modern China means 1949 to now. Since the founding of the People's Republic of China in 1949, China has entered a communist era of stability with the reform and opening up policy of 1978 bringing in China's phenomenal economic growth. During the Second World War, there were prevailed widespread unemployment, extreme poverty and worst economic exploitation in China. Because of a long continued struggle with Japan, the country was in ruins. All the big industries and manufacturing houses were then owned by the foreigners. Japan finally surrendered in 1945. After Japan's withdrawal from China was quickly accomplished, there broke out in China a civil war between Mao's Red Army and the national government led by Chiang Kai-shek. By the end of 1949, all of the China proper, Chinese mainland, was controlled by the Communist Party. The People's Republic of China was officially then proclaimed in 1949. Okay? It has long history. Like 1931 Civil War, fighting between the Red Army and the Nationalist Party was 18-year long conflict. Then 1937 to 1945, the second Sino-Japanese war tension started with Japanese invasion of Manchuria in 1937. In 1945, Japanese surrendered in World War II. In 1949, People's Republic of China, after violent and staged to the civil war, the Communist Party declared the People's Republic of China. Communist Party chairman then Mao Zedong became China's new leader. Okay. 1949, Mao's government, like that of the Soviet Union, brought all means and instruments of production and distribution, such as factories, banks and commercial establishment, under the ownership of state. The agricultural was distributed among peasantry. Soon after the Communist Revolution, the Chinese government focused on economic and social repair as well as political question. Its economic program of creating heavy industries and steel complexes. First, this model allowed China to use its resources to establish the foundations of an industrial economy on a scale that did not exist before. Second, employment and social welfare was assured to all citizens. China moved ahead of most developing countries in educating its citizens and ensuring better health for them. Third, the economy also grew at a respectable rate of 5 to 6%, but an annual growth of 2 to 3% in population meant that economic growth was insufficient to meet the needs of a growing population. Then agriculture production was not sufficient to generate a surplus of industry for industry. Its industrial production was not growing fast enough. International trade was minimal and per capita income was very low. Okay, the China was then not able to get rid of its backwardness because of people's growing needs and shortage of many kinds. Then Chinese leaders are forced to take many important political decisions. In 25th October 1971, China was admitted to the United Nations and it also became a permanent member of the Security Council. Now, China's political isolation had ended. Chinese leaders visited various countries. They signed agreements on cooperation in trade, education, science and technology. In 1973, Chinese Prime Minister Zhou Enlai embarked upon a program of 4 modernizations of agriculture, industry, armed forces and science and technology. He said the goal of party is to modernize agriculture, industry, national security and science technology and to transform China into a powerful leader socialist country. Mao died in 1976. Chinese leaders felt it necessary to liberalize trade and investment. In 1978, China's powerful leader Deng Xiaoping announced a reformist and liberal policy. It was known as Open Door Policy. Deng called it China's Second Revolution. The policy was to generate high productivity by investments of capital and technology from abroad. Okay. And start industries. Then trade barriers were eliminated. China, the state, played and it continues to play a central role in setting up a market economy. Okay. The new economic policies helped the Chinese economy to break from stagnation. Privatization of agriculture led to a remarkable rise in agriculture production and rural incomes. High personal savings in the rural economy led to an exponential growth in rural industry. The Chinese economy, including both industry and agriculture, grew at a faster rate. The new trading laws and the creation of special economic zones led to a phenomenal rise in foreign trade. China has become the most important destination for foreign direct investment or FDI anywhere in the world. It has large foreign exchange reserves that now allow it to make big investment in other countries. After negotiations that continued for a long period of time, China finally became a member of WTO and World Trade Organization. Now decided to open its economy to many new areas such as banking, tourism and telecommunication. In the year 2004, foreign companies entered insurance sectors. In 2006, China announced heavy reductions in duties on the import of foreign cars. The laws relating to acquisition of private property, public use have been changed. The new laws do provide a fair compensation to those agriculturalists whose lands are acquired for public use. China is largest economy. It is also going to become biggest economic and strategic power next only to USA. Today, China has emerged as the world's largest producer of steel and cement. China's share is more than 60% of the world trade turnover in the year of 2006. 80% of the world's consumer electronics were made in China, with a sustained growth rate of 9 to 10% for the past many years. China stood with a $4 trillion economy in the year of 2010. Foreign companies are paying heavy pay package to their skilled workers and managers. As a result, new professionals has emerged in China. This led to great economic inequalities between different social classes, between urban and rural populations, and between industrial coastal cities and regions within inland provinces. While the Chinese economy has improved dramatically, not everyone in China has received the benefits of the reforms. Unemployment has risen in China, with nearly 100 million people looking for jobs. Female employment and conditions of work are as bad as in Europe of the 18th and 19th centuries. Environmental degradation and corruption have increased. However, regionally, globally, China has been in limelight economic power. So, over the past 35 years, China has undergone major social economic transformation that have had a huge domestic impact and redefined its relationship with the rest of the world. The 1980s saw the first phase of reforming and opening up. In the 1990s, the pace of global economic integration increased. This economic transformation entered a new and most substantial phase of global integration, following China's accession to the World Trade Organization. In 2000, the size of China's economy became a dominant feature of any narratives of global change, symbolized by its overtaking of Japan to become the world's second largest economy by aggregate GDP in 2010. So, inevitably, China has become for the United States a symbol of a future in which its control is diminished. China depicts as the only country with the potential to challenge the United States in military and economic terms. China is well on its way to becoming a formidable global power. So it has become one of the world's major manufacturing centers and consumes roughly a third of the global supply of iron, steel and coal. So China is emerging as both a military and economic rival, a profound shift in distribution of global power. So the 21st century is often referred to as the Asian or Pacific century, indicating a shift of economic and political power from the United States and Europe towards the emerging economies of Asia. While the financial crisis in 2008 hit the US and Europe hard, the rates of growth in Asia was greatly affected. Through this period, the world witnessed new phase in the process of globalization, marking the end of hegemony on the West, Europe, Japan. But China's development, as well as that of the rest of Asia, as per the observer of the Chinese rise, will necessarily alter the permanent geopolitical position that the United States has enjoyed since the end of the Cold War and then Western nations have enjoyed since the 19th century. According to a study by the Pew Research Center, almost half of respondents across all regions believe that China has overtaken the US as the world's leading superpower. Thank you, students. This is all about China. Welcome, students. Hope you are all doing well. Now I am going to discuss about a country like Israel of the chapter New Centers of Power from the Book of Contemporary World Politics. So here it is. Israel. Official state of Israel or Israel is a small country in the Middle East located at the eastern end of the Mediterranean Sea. Israel became an independent country in 1948 and it is the only Jewish country in the world. It had long history. Between 1922 and 1948, the land was legally and officially under the rule of the British. It was then officially called as Palestine in English. It is bounded to the north by Lebanon, to the northeast by Syria, to the east and southeast by Jordan, to the southwest by Egypt, and to the west by the Mediterranean Sea. Jerusalem is the seat of government and the proclaimed capital, or its capital is Jerusalem. Prime Minister is Benjamin Netanyahu. Its most sacred sites are in Jerusalem. Israel's financial hub, Tel Aviv, is known for its Bauhaus architecture and beaches. It has land borders with Lebanon, Syria, Jordan, the Palestinian territories of the West Bank and Gaza Strip and Egypt. Now, when Israel was under British mandate 1920 to 1948, then the whole region was known as Palestine. Okay. Palestine, upon independence in 1948, the country formally adopted the name State of Israel. The British controlled Palestine until Israel in the years following the end of World War II. Then it became an independent state in 1947. Israel is the only Jewish country and Jews all over the world think of Israel as their spiritual home. The region that now falls within its border has a lengthy and rich history that dates from pre-biblical times. The area was then a part of the Roman Empire after getting as an independent nation. Okay. Israel fought a series of wars against neighboring Arab states during the next 35 years after independence, which have resulted in ongoing disputes over territory and the status of refugees. Despite continuing tensions, however, Israel concluded peace treaties with several neighboring Arab states during the final quarter of the 20th century. Okay. It has been locked in conflict with the Palestinians and its Arab neighbors over ownership of land considered holy by many Jews, Christians and Muslims since its creation in 1948. The division of the former British Mandate of Palestine and the creation of the State of Israel in the years after the end of the Second World War was the culmination of the Zionist movement, whose aim was a homeland for Jews, hitherto scattered all over the world. On May 14, 1948, Zionist leader David Ben-Gurion proclaimed the creation of the State of Israel, formed out of Palestine, where the British mandate had expired hours before. Zionism, the movement, aimed at bringing together Jews in Palestine of Israel's workforce. But much of the work was performed by people, was now performed by missions. Important agriculture products include citrus and other fruits, eggs, grain, poultry and vegetables. The government develops, health, finance and controls agricultural activity, including fishing and forestry also. Most Israel farmers use modern agricultural methods. In mining, the Dead Sea, the world's saltiest body of water, is Israel's leading source of minerals, magnesium, potassium and table salt. Okay, in energy, Israel has few energy sources. It has no coal deposits or hydroelectric power resources and only small amounts of crude oil and natural gas. As a result, Israel depends on imported crude oil. Okay, solar energy. Energy from the sun is used widely to heat water for houses. Israel is developing other ways to use solar energy to power houses and factories. In international trade, for 2006, Israel exports grew by 11% to just over 29 billion. The high tech sector accounted 14 billion and 20% increase from the previous year. Because it has few natural resources, Israel imports more goods than it exports. The country's main imports include chemicals, computer equipment, grain, iron, steel, military equipment, petroleum products, rough diamonds and textiles. Israel's main exports are chemical products. Okay, citrus fruits, clothing, electronic equipments, fertilizers, polished diamonds, military equipments and processed foods. Okay, in transportation, Israel has a well-developed transportation system. Ben-Gurion Airport is Israel's main international airport. It is near Tel Aviv. Israel's international airline flies regularly to the United States, like Canada, Europe and parts of Africa and Asia. In communications, Israel's communication system is one of the best in the Middle East. Israel has about 30 daily newspapers, about half are featured in Hebrew. Now, I'll be discussing about conflict between Jews and Arabs or Arabian countries. Throughout Israel's long history, tensions between Jews and Arab Muslims have existed. The complex hostility between the two groups dates all the way back to ancient times, when they both populated the area and deemed in holy place of Palestine. Both Jews and Muslims consider the city of Jerusalem sacred. Much of the conflict in recent years has centered around who is occupying the following areas. For example, Gaza Strip, Golan Heights. Okay, the Zionism movement. Now, what is the Zionism movement? In the late 19th and early 20th century, an organized religious and political movement known as Zionism emerged among Jews. Zionists wanted to re-establish a Jewish homeland in Palestine. Massive numbers of Jews immigrated to the ancient Holy Land and built settlements. Between 1882 and 1903, about 35,000 Jews relocated to Palestine. Another 40,000 settled in the area between 1904 and 1914. Many Jews living in Europe and elsewhere fearing persecution during the Nazi regime found refuge in Palestine and embraced Zionism. After the World War II ended, members of the Zionist movement primarily focused on creating an independent Jewish state in Jerusalem. Arabs in Palestine, mainly Muslim regions, they opposed the Zionism movement, and tensions became continued between the two groups people, like Muslims and Jewish people. An Arab nationalist movement developed as a result. Then the United Nations approved a plan to partition Palestine into Jews and Arab state in 1947, but the Arab rejected it. In May 1948, Israel was officially declared an independent state with David Ben-Gurion, the head of the Jewish agency, as the prime minister. While the historic event seemed to be a victory for Jews, it also marked the beginning of more violence with the Arabs. Okay, 1948 Arab and Israel War. Following the announcement of an independent Israel, five Arab nations like Egypt, Jordan, Iraq, Syria and Lebanon immediately invaded the region in what became known as the 1948 Arab-Israel War. Civil war broke out throughout all of Israel, but a ceasefire agreement was reached in 1949 as part of the temporary agreement. The West Bank became part of Jordan and the Gaza Strip became Egyptian territory. Numerous wars and acts of violence between Arabs and Jews have occurred since the 1948 Arab-Israel War. Some of this include Israel today. Clashes between Israelis and Palestinians are still commonplace. Are going on now, key terrorists of land are divided, but some are claimed by both groups. For instance, they both cite Jerusalem as their capital. Both groups blame each other for terror attacks that kill civilians. While Israel doesn't officially recognize Palestine as a state, more than 135 UN members also. As a solution of conflict between Arab Israel, several countries have pushed for more peace agreements in recent years. Many have suggested a two-state solution, but acknowledge that Israelis and Palestinians are unlikely to settle on borders. Israel Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has supported the two-state solution, but has felt pressure to change his stance. Netanyahu has also been accused of encouraging Jewish settlements in Palestinian areas while still backing a two-state solution. The United States is one of the Israel's closest allies. In a visit to Israel in May 2017, U.S. President Donald Trump urged Netanyahu to embrace peace agreement with Palestinians. While Israel has been plagued by unpredictable war and violence in the past, many national leaders and citizens are hoping for a secure, stable nation in the future. So, students, this is all about Israel. I hope this one clear. So, thank you for watching and do study well. Percentage